Shalom, Yasha'Allah. Once again, you're now under the sounds of the voice of Kahan Tazadah Shah. And I entitled this video, Sovereignty, Contract Law, Tazadah Shah Bey, It's Great to Be King. Sovereignty is actually supreme power or authority. In this video, I intend to actually try to educate you and actually wrapping your brain around the concept of contract law and grasping the fundamental rules and principles that actually governs contract law and understanding contract formations, defenses, and interpretations, and getting you up to speed on performances, breach, and remedies. I know you want to actually learn from this very informative video. As usual, this is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel, and then please, please be advised. What I'm about to provide is for educational, informational, entertainment purposes only. And I encourage you to watch this video at least 4 times, but I recommend 10 to embed this into your subconscious mind so it will become a natural reaction. This is not intended as legal advice. If you find the information in this video of value, please click the PayPal link below the video and donate whatever value you may find the video to be worth. You may find it to be worth $300, $200, $100, $50, $1,000, because it may very well save you from a commercial presentment that may have cost you thousands. With that being said, contract law may feel overwhelming to many of you, especially, you know, some of you may be students of law. You've been into some law class which you're actually required to read and analyze case after case. I myself have a few so-called friends that's lawyers, attorneys. And I say so-called friends because I don't trust them any further than I could throw Walmart. Now, add into that load are many sources of contract law, including the common law. You know, the restatement of contracts. Restatement of contracts. The Uniform Commercial Code, UCC. Federal and state statutes and rules that essentially governs when parties are allowed or prohibit from coming up with their own contract terms. Now, although the details swirling around the topic of contract law, contract is law, and law is contract. Once you thoroughly embrace that concept, then you will actually understand the law, the contract. So, swirling around the topic of contract law are important, placing those details actually into context essentially makes them more manageable and actually enables you to see the big picture. Now, that's what this video is about. Now, here you get the eye in the sky view of contract law and a framework on which to hang this rich tapestry of policies, principles, and rules collectively referred to as contract. Contract is law, and law is contract, a phrase worthy to be repeated again and again. Now, grasping the concept of contract law. Now, contrary to popular belief, law isn't just a bunch of rules, regulation that essentially governs agreements between people. It's not developed and imposed from, you know, some superficial rule-making authority. It actually developed naturally over the course of thousands of years by way of the interactions and transactions between people like you and I, the parties who formed contracts, which became law. So in this video, I'll explain what a contract is, present a few different perspectives on the principle that should actually drive the formation of contract rules, and then briefly explore how contract law developed into what it is today. Now, from apples to contracts, grasping the purposes of contracts. Now, to begin to grasp the concept of contract, it's all about imagine a group of people on a deserted island trying to figure out ways to govern their relationships amongst each other. They want to be a community, but they also want each person to have an autonomy. Now, collectively, these people decide that each one of them may own property and make agreements about what to do with that property. Now, they discover that the free exchange of property actually increases the wealth and well-being of parties. For example, case in point, if one of the people has a surplus of apples and a shortage of fish, and another person has a surplus of fish but no apples, the two may exchange goods for mutual benefit. Do you understand? So if the parties take the next step and decide that they can promise in advance to perform such exchanges, their agreement actually indicates the beginning of the contract of the law. Now, as certain issues may arise, these people on the island form rules that actually address those issues, such as how quickly the parties must perform the acceptable quality of the apples and fish, and the consequences for non-performances. Do you understand? So their system of law grows organically from the ground up, not from the top down. Do you understand? Now, defining the contract. A contract is simply, folks, a promise or a set of promises enforceable by law. Wait, the contract is the law. But this agreement are enforceable by law varies from culture to culture. So what's acceptable in one culture may not be acceptable in another. So if I agree to sell you my home, for example, the home selling culture says that I can't make any untruthful statement about the home. But if I can agree to pay a hand in the World Series of poker, then the poker culture says that I can't make any truthful statements about my hand. Do you follow me? So the United States does not have a monolithic contract law which actually uniform rules. Contract law is nuisance and fact intensive. So a rule may actually differ, case in point, depending on whether the parties or two giant corporations having their own lawyers negotiate an agreement, or family members making an agreement over the dinner table. So comparing different schools of thought on contract rules. So the overriding principle that actually guides the formation of contract rules vary according to the different schools of thought, depending on your perspective. You may think that the rules should actually be based on what is. Now, folks, customarily and reasonable. So in most systems of contract law, the rule that develops is usually based on what's customarily and reasonable. So with nearly every issue that arises in contract law, just think what's reasonable and you'll usually discover the rule. Does this make sense? Now, it also should be economically efficient. Now, my economist friends think that the rule should actually be based on what most economically is efficient. Now, according to the economist, people enter contracts for their mutual financial benefit. Case in point, you agree to sell and I agree to buy your car for $7,000. Because right now, the $7,000 is worth more to you than the car, and the car is worth more to me than the $7,000. Do you understand? Excuse me. See, I have in my land bank throughout this, video, I sometimes share the economist perspective. But if you haven't studied econ or read Economics for Dummies by Wiley, then stick with asking what's reasonable and you'll come up with the rule most of the time. Do you follow me? So it must be fair. The contract must be fair for the little guy. Now, according to many sources in the critical studies movement, the people in power who happen to be rich white men, I'm going to say it like it is, I must tell the truth, made the rules. So these rich Edomites, these rich guys came up with rules that are favorable to them. So contract law needs to watch out for the little guy who gets the worst of it in the contracts. Do you understand? Now, folks, regardless of view, everyone would probably agree that one of the most difficult problems facing contract law today is the ease with which consumers can bind themselves to contracts by clicking I agree to the terms and conditions that nobody reads. You just click. And this is quite different from the contract created by a carefully negotiated exchange on drafts, or is it? Now, throughout your career in contract law, you'll struggle to determine whether the same rules apply in both situations. Now, let's trace back to some of the roots of contract law. Now, most contract law in the United States comes from England. It's indisputable, it's unrefutable. Now, where it was actually largely based on the traditional or tradition commonly referred to as common law, which comes from who? The Creator, which comes from the Bible, meaning the law made by judges to some. Now, many of the rules of commercial law that governs buying, selling, and financially comes from medieval times. Now, anytime parties traded, they had to have an understanding of the deal they were making. They made their own rules, called the law merchant to govern their situation. Do you understand? So, as the law became more specialized, various areas of contract law were spun off and now stand on their own. For instance, insurance law, banking law, government procurement law, are all areas of contract law that you don't study in a standard contract law courts. Now, one authority has called contract law the law of leftovers. Now, general principles that remain irrespective of the substance of the transactions. Now, what are the key players? Common law, the restatement, and the UCC. These are the key players in contract law. Now, although you'll find no definitive collection of the rules and regulation that actually governs contracts, you can find guidance from three primary resources: the common law, the restatement of contracts, and the Uniform Commercial Code, UCC. I refer to these resources throughout this video and the video to come. So you need to have a general understanding of how each resource actually contributes to contract law. Now let's first explore the common law, the traditions and precedents. Now, in Anglo-America, meaning the English and American tradition, contract law was common law. Judges decided each dispute on the basis of traditions and recorded precedent. Now, imagine yourself the lord of a manor in merry old England, and the parties to a dispute look to you for wisdom. Now, you likely ask, what have we done in the past? Does it make any sense today? The same question today's judges should ask. Now, in a common law system, if you want to find out what the outcome is likely to be under a particular fact pattern, you have to read all the applicable cases, which means the reported court decisions, case law, and then synthesize them. That's what you do in your legal research and writing class, and you sometimes do it in contract class if you're a student of law, when you have a string of cases to read. So you don't read them in isolation. You try to see the connections and be prepared to say why one case came out one way and the other came out another way. Do you understand? Now, because the common law rule of stare decisis, let the decision stand, courts generally follow precedent. Now, therefore, you can actually fairly accurately predict what a court will do in the future based on what the court has done in the past, because that predictive power is important to business entering transactions. Contract law is slow to change. Now, capturing the general rules in the restatement process. Now, although the common law approaches is effective, sometimes you just want to know what the general rule is, devoid of the particular fact situation. Now, having to read all the cases on point to find a rule would be a pain in the behind. Now, fortunately, someone has always been willing to read all those cases and try to synthesize them into black letter rules. Now, attempts to capture the essence of each rule. So in the 18th century, that someone was Sir William Blackstone. Surely some of you have heard of Blackstone, who wrote the commentaries on the laws of England, 1765 to 1769. Now, in those days, lawyers, actually including many of the so-called founding fathers, relied on Blackstone for this purpose. Now, contract law has the restatement. Now, the restatement of laws are an effort by the American Law Institute, which is actually a group of law professors, lawyers, judges, and other interested parties to actually reduce the law to workable sets of black letter rules. So the first restatement of contracts came in 1932. The principal reporter was Samuel Williston. He wrote one of the great multi-volume treaties on contract law. So the rules in this restatement are somewhat rigid and don't always reflect the modern legal thinking, which often takes into consideration a number of missing factors instead of drawing bright lines. Now, a second restatement of contract was actually promulgated in 1981 with Alan Farnsworth as a reporter. Now, when I refer to the restatement, I mean the second restatement. So, although the restatement is a great resource, recognize, folks, its limitations. Recognize its limitations. It is not intact law, so it has only persuasive authority. Now, if you're citing law to a judge, the judge wants to know what the higher courts in that particular jurisdiction have actually held, not what the restatement says. Do you understand? Do you understand? So it actually represents a limited number of views. People holding conflicting views of what should be the rule, with some jurisdiction following one line of reasons and others following another. So the restatement generally chooses the majority view, as in mob rule situations. So you may get the misimpression from its restatement or of a rule that the law is more settled than it is. And on a few occasions, the restatement that the minority view, because the drafters thought it represented the better view. So, folks, many publications of the restatement for students contain only the rules. Excuse me. So, the complete edition includes commentaries and illustrations to help you more fully understand each rule. Now, statutes, essentially supplanting common law with codes. Now, although contract law is traditionally common law, statutes enacted by legislators are increasingly taking over the rule of common law. And this is an atrocity. The courts have to follow the laws enacted by legislators. So, what does that mean to you? Watch who you're voting into office. And if they're not doing their jobs, vote them, get them out. So, if the law has a statute on point, that should be the starting point for a court. Now, as many of you are probably aware, many European countries have civil law systems based largely on systematic arrangements of statutes called codes. Now, these particular systems have an authoritative source to go to in order to find the governing contract law. Louisiana, because of its French origins, had a civil code of contract, and so do many other states. Now, in the mid-19th century, a codification movement in England and the United States sought to codify the law in order to make it more accessible, and the codifiers won out in a number of states, including California, which has codified the law of contract in its civil codes. But don't believe me? Go and check it out for yourself. So, but these codes often just state common law rules and principles, leaving the courts plenty of room to interpret the statute and apply it to a particular situation. And this is what's going on. And this is why many of you are getting shafted by the black role. Now, contract law is mostly state law rather than federal law. Although no federal common law of contracts exists, a number of federal statutes govern contracts. Now, most of these are in the consumer and credit area. So when you have a transaction in these areas, check for any relevant federal statutes. Now, let's touch on the UCC for a little bit. Let's brush up on the Uniform Commercial Code. Now, if each state had the same statutes govern contracts, then the law would be easier to find and more predictable, so they say, which is especially important in commercial law that applies to many interstate transactions. So Congress could actually probably enact an American Commercial Code based on its authority to regulate interstate commerce. So, but Congress has left this project to the states. So the states have actually turned to the assistance of what? Uniform Commercial Code. The Uniform Law Commission. The ULC. The Uniform Law Commission. A private group which essentially with representatives from every state that actually aspires to write model statutes that get law right and that are intactable. So when the ULC agrees on a model statute, the process is only just beginning because the model statute isn't yet law, or what they call law. It can never be law. Statutes, legislators must enact the statutes for them to become what they call law, which is really not law. So the ULC, with the assistance of the America Law Institute, the folks that's responsible for the restatements, has had some so-called success getting states to enact the Uniform Commercial Code, which contains a number of articles addressing various aspects of commercial law. Now, Cole Ludwig first drafted this model in the 1940s, and the states began to enact it in the 1960s. Article 2, which deals with the sale of goods, is the article most relevant to contract law. Do you understand? Do you understand? I hope you're soaking this in. Now, the ULC is frequently unable to achieve its goal of uniformity because states can and often do alter the uniform version. So although every state has intact the UCC, Louisiana has not intact Article 2. They've always intact slightly different versions. In this video, I generally cite North Carolina's version, not out of some love for the first in flight state, but because the uniform version is under copyright, whereas an enacted statute is the public dominion. So in your law studies, if you are a student of law or at law, you'll probably be working with the restatement and the uniform version of the UCC as promulgated by the ULC. But remember, folks, when you have a research question in a certain jurisdiction, you need to look up the law in that state to make sure that it's the same. Do you understand? Do you understand? And I want you to take notice, attempts to revise the UCC Article 2 have come to an end. But Article 1 underwent a revision process in 2001. Most states have actually enacted revised Article 1, which is also used on the multi-state bar exam that these lawyers take. So that's the version of Article 1 that I'll refer to in my videos. when doing research in a particular jurisdiction, you must find out what is the applicable law in your jurisdiction. So, if you look at some of the UCC principles, I'm not going to be much longer. I'm going to have to turn this into two videos because I don't want it to take too much of your time. So, now, although UCC Article 2 gets the most press, you also encounter references to UCC Article 1, which deals with the basic principles and definitions that apply throughout the code, including Article 2. So some of the basic principles found in Article 1 are so important that I cite them repeatedly. I discuss two of the most significant provisions. Next, freedom of contract, letting parties agree to a different rule. Now, one important principle, folks, of UCC Article 1 is what I call the freedom of contract provision, Section 1, 302A, and intact in North Carolina at 25-1-302A provides the following. 25-1-302, variation by agreement, except as otherwise provided in subsection B of this section or elsewhere in the Uniform Commercial Code, the effort of provisions of the Uniform Commercial Code may be varied by agreement. So this important rule, folks, offers guidance on how to think of the law, I mean the contract. Contract law is not a bunch of regulations that parties to a contract must follow. Often, contract law facilitates a transaction by providing a rule that kicks in if the parties neglect to provide their own rules. So the rules are often called default rules because, like the default setting of your computer, they apply unless you change them. But very often, as UCC 1-302A states, some contracts law gives the parties the freedom of contract to come up with their own rules. So some of the rules are regulatory, and unfortunately, the code isn't always helpful in identifying whether a particular rule is regulatory, meaning it can't be changed, or facilitatory, can be changed by the parties' mutual agreement. Case in point, for example, that 1-302B states some obligations that parties can't get out of by agreement. But that same provision goes on to say that you can determine standards by which the performance of those obligations is to be measured. You can't, for example, agree not to be reasonable, but you can agree. See, it is to be considered reasonable if we do A, B, and C. So figuring out the interplay between what is permissible in some circumstances and not permissible in one of the greatest challenges of studying contract law. So, folks, as you study the law, try to identify which are regulatory rules that have to be followed and which are the facilitatory rules that the parties are free to exchange. Take a nuisance view. And if the court doesn't let the parties change the rules, ask why. Was it because the parties were in a particular state, entered into a particular kind of transaction, had an imbalance of power? So with that, brothers and sisters, I'm going to bring this video to a close. I trust that you've learned something from this. Be sure to tune in to the next video. Teach you a little more on contract law. And if you find this video of value, please click the PayPal link below and donate whatever value you may find this video to be worth. And if you need some education or direction with a commercial presentment, click the email link below and someone will be in contact with you as promptly as possible. Creditors, debtors, contracts at yahoo.com. Or if you would like to become a secured party creditor and take yourself out from under the de facto, again, click the email link below and someone will be in contact with you as promptly as possible. So, until next time, Tyler Doc Shaw signing off. Say shalom, yasha Allah. Peace and blessings be upon you all.